Welcome everybody. I'm Gabor Horvath, a PhD student right now, and I'm going to talk about static analysis. More specifically, I will talk about some Clang tools. So I will introduce you what static analysis is, why should you care, and why is it hard in general to develop such tools. We will look into how some of those tools work, and also we will look through some of the open source alternatives that you can use, and look at how can you integrate it into your workflow. And in the end, if we have still some time, we will talk about how to write code that is friendly to static analysis tools, which is very useful because code that is very friendly to those tools sometimes happens to be also much cleaner and easier to maintain. So static analysis is about analyzing the code without executing it. It has wide variety of use cases, but in this talk, I will mainly think of static analysis as a bug finding tool. So we are going to talk about how to find bugs using these methods. When we are doing static analysis, we would like to answer several different questions about our code. And basically, when we are doing development and we are looking at some code and try to understand what it do, and then we are doing static analysis manually. So it's kind of close to us. Unfortunately, it is a very question.
Can a static analysis tool determine whether the program terminates?
So the question was, can a static analysis program determine whether a program terminates? And the answer is unfortunately no. So maybe you are familiar with the halting problem. It is undecidable whether a program terminates on a given input. And in fact, every interesting question about the program is undecidable. It follows from the Rice's theorem. And for example, there is a little piece of program and we might wonder whether the value of X during the execution of the program might change or not. And in order to answer this question, which looks very innocent, we need to solve the halting problem, which we can't, of course. So the question is, how can we reason about code when we have such severe limitations? So of course, what good engineers do this time, they do approximations. So for example, we can approximate or use heuristics to do some level of reasoning, even though it is not perfect, but it has a cost. So the cost is we might have false positives when the static analysis tool reports an error for correct code, or we might have false negatives when the static analysis tool is unable to find some errors that it should find. And when we are doing verification, we would like to eliminate all of the false negatives, and this will result in more false positives, of course. But if we are trying to apply static analysis tools to industrial code bases that do not require verification, then the goal is to reduce the number of false positives, because we do not want to take the time of the developers to go over false positive results. We want to utilize their time as good as we can, so they can fix real bugs. So why should we bother with static analysis at all when we have dynamic analysis and we have testing? And there are several reasons to still employ static analysis tools. One of the reasons is that we do not need to execute our code to do this. And because of this, we can also benefit from these tools when we have very poor code coverage, and also when the runtime environment is not available for some reason. And also, we can use static analysis to enforce coding guidelines, and enforcing coding guidelines can make our code much more cleaner and much more easy to maintain. And it is also a cheap supplement to testing or dynamic analysis. So using static analysis does not make it impossible to use other testing methods or quality, software quality control methods. And it also helps to find bugs early in the development cycle. And the earlier we find the bug, it is the cheaper to fix it. So static analysis is a hard problem, but analyzing C++ is even harder. One of the problems is that the compilation model is kind of outdated, and the compiler and static analysis tools needs to parse very huge amount of code, because the headers generate and the preprocessor generate a lot of input for those tools. Models might help, but unfortunately, it takes some time to get it into the standard and get a wider adoption. And also, the C++ grammar is ambiguous. So in order to parse it, we need type information to disambiguate these ambiguities. For example, if we just look at the first line of code here, we cannot determine whether this is a multiplication of two variables or declaration of a pointer without knowing what t actually is. Or the next line, we cannot be sure whether this is a call to a function, declaration of a variable, or a cast. Or on the last line, we cannot be sure whether it is a dereference of a pointer followed by a cast or a multiplication. So we do need the type information in order to parse C++ code. So parsing and semantic analysis cannot be split. And this sometimes can make it more difficult to develop static analysis tools for C++. And also, macros make it very hard to do semantic preserving rewrites. So in case we would like to transform our code with these static analysis tools, and we use a lot of macros, we are out of luck, because it is not possible to do it easily. And also, because of macros, we cannot just cache the representation that is used by those static analyzers of the header files, because the header files might be included with different macro options into each translation unit. So this makes it a very hard problem. In the next few slides, I will talk about some methods, how these tools actually work. So there are several additional methods that are exist, but these are some of the most common ones that are used in bug finding tools. So the first one is textual pattern matching, when we transform our code to a canonical form and we try to match textual patterns on the transformed code. And with this technique, we might be able to find some kind of errors, for example, this division by zero error, but we are unable to find other kinds of errors. For example, here we might see that there is a division by zero error, but it is not possible to find it only by textual pattern matching. In case we match the syntax tree, we can do much more, because the syntax tree contains the type information, and we might spot that we would like to allocate the memory for double, but unfortunately in this case the amount of bytes we are allocating is not necessarily the same amount that it is required for a double, because we forget to dereference D because of before calling the size of operator. So looking at the types in the syntax tree can help us diagnose such errors. And because the type defs and overloads and templates are all resolved in the AST, in the syntax tree, we can much more easily find other kind of errors as well. So let's look at the flow sensitive algorithms. Flow sensitive algorithms do a work on the control flow graph. The control flow graph has basic blocks as its nodes that are executed sequentially, and all the jump or branch instructions are edges along these nodes. So if we would like to find division by zero errors, we might start to analyze this code. And in the first basic block, we know that the value of x is zero. And then we will find the branch, and we either take the branch or do not take the branch. If we take the branch, then the value of x will be non-zero. If we do not take the branch, the value of x remains zero. And after these two execution pads falls together, there is a question, what should we do on these merge points? And usually we can define a lattice that helps, that determines what to do, which is an ordering of the possible states. So right now we define the lattice in a way that when either of the branches the value of x is zero, then we conclude that the value of zero of x is zero in the merge point, and we then will see yet another branch, and in this case we will report a division by zero error, but it is a false positive report because the two conditions of these two branches are correlated. So each time we take the true branch of the true branch of the second if statement, we also took the two branch of the first one, so there should not be a division by zero error reported here. So let's try to fix it. I also changed the second condition this time. So the analysis starts the same way it started the first time, but let's define the lattice a bit differently. So this time, when we merge together two execution pads, and we should only conclude that the value of a variable is zero if it is zero on all of the pads. And in this case, we have a false negative result because we will not find the division by zero that will happen in this case. So a flow sensitive algorithm is a polynomial, so it's great because it's fast, but it is very imprecise. We either had a lot of false positives or a lot of false negatives. So one possible improvement is to use pass sensitive algorithms. In pass sensitive algorithms, we do a pass sensitive work over the control flow graph. And this basically means that we do not merge after the end of two branches. We let the number of pads to explode. Because of this, the execution time of such an algorithm will be exponential in the branching factor. But it with some tricks and heuristics, it can be manageable for very large code bases. So we try to do a simulated execution. Then we try to enumerate all of the execution pads of our application. And there will be, of course, some unknown values. For example, when we read something from the user or we load a value from a configuration that we cannot know at compile time, and we need to somehow account for those unknown values, and we use symbols to do this. And along the execution path, we record what constraints are available for a given symbol. So, for example, we might know that what the value should be for a certain branch. And using this information, we would like to avoid taking impossible execution paths, because those paths will lead to false positive results. So, in order to understand this concept, let's look at an example. So when we are trying to analyze this code, we have no way to know what the value of b is. So we represent the value of b with a symbol. We know nothing about this symbol yet. There is a default branch, and on the default branch, nothing interesting happens. But we know that the value of b can be anything but 1 or 4. In case the value of b is 1, then we can detect the division by 0 error. In case the value of b is 4, then we can conclude that the value of c must be 0, so we can find the division by 0 error. So basically, using these symbolic values and constraints on those values, we can reason about the program code. And what these tools do, they are representing the state of our program somehow, and they are doing state transitions along the way while they are doing this symbolic execution, and they are trying to find errors this way. So they are trying to find states that can result in runtime errors. So one fundamental question of static analysis is, how should we represent memory? So there are some questions about memory that a good analyzer should be able to answer, or that some property that the good analyzer should be able to reason about. It is very important to know about aliasing and the hierarchical nature of the memory, and also sometimes about locality. And one possibility is to represent memory as memory regions. For example, if we have an array on the stack, then we might represent somehow that the array is the memory region that represents the array is a subregion of the stack, and the element is the subregion of the array region. And if we refer to a field inside the element, that field region is the subregion of the corresponding element region. So basically, for example, the Clang static analyzer does this, and it also representation also encodes some information about the locality. So we might know that the two elements are close to each other, and we might know that when something is on the heap and something else is on the stack, they are at very different memory regions. So okay, let's talk about intra-procedural or inter-procedural analysis. When we only do the analysis inside the function or a method, we are talking about an intra-procedural analysis. But when we do our analysis across function boundaries, then this is an inter-procedural analysis. And in case of inter-procedural analysis, we might wonder whether it is context sensitive or not. So what context sensitivity means, if we look at the getNull function, we might conclude that it will return 0 only in case the argument that was passed to it is equal to 5. So basically, we should only report the division by zero error when we know that the value was that was passed to this function was 5. So that's what context sensitivity is about. And when we do inter-procedural analysis, we might also wonder whether the analyzer that we are using is able to reason about code across the translation unit boundaries. So why is it important to reason about code across translation unit boundaries? Let's look at this example. When there is the first call to the function f, we know that the value that is pointed by the pointer x is positive because of the condition at the branch. So in case we do not do cross-translation unit analysis and we cannot know what the function body of the function f looks like, then we have no idea what f does to the value that is pointed by the pointer x. So we need to erase all of the information that we collected about this value so far. So when there is the next call to the function f, we know nothing about the value that is pointed by this pointer. So when we face an unknown function, it's not the case that we only cannot reason about what that function does, but it is also the case that we might actually lose information that we were able to collect so far. So this information loss problem is can be very severe. So it is good when a static analysis tool can reason about code across the translation unit boundaries. When we have the analysis tool that can reason about code across translation unit boundaries, then we might have other boundaries as well. For example, module boundaries, project boundaries, and it is even better when we can cross those boundaries too. However, we might use closed source libraries as well. So it is likely that we will always have some kind of boundary that limits our analysis. One possibility to do inter-procedural or cross-translation unit or cross-module analysis is to use a summary-based analysis. When we use some kind of summary information about a function, what is a summary depends on the analysis that we are doing. And basically, instead of inlining the function call or instead of evaluating the code of that function in place, we can use the information from the summary, or we can do it on a translation unit boundary or a module boundary. Okay, so we were talking about some general ideas, how these tools work, and let's talk about some of the open source tools. I think at this point, from the title of this talk, you figured out that I will mostly talk about Clang-related tools. And so let's look at what can they do. So the Clang static analyzer is path sensitive, and it does the symbolic execution that we looked at earlier. So it can do a very powerful analysis. It can reason about the code really well. It has good memory modeling capabilities, and it is context sensitive. Unfortunately, it lacks the cross translation unit analysis support. But again, yes.
Could you get around that by making a source file that includes .cpp, include the other.cpp, and you know?
Okay. So the question was, can we circumvent this cross-translation unit analysis support by, for example, using a Unity build when we include everything into one translation unit? And the answer is yes. So if we are able to do a Unity build, then we do not need the cross-translation unit analysis support, and this can improve the analysis very significantly. Unfortunately, we lose this way the incremental analysis, so when we would like to only reanalyze the changed source files, and also the memory requirement to analyze a huge translation unit might be enormous. So it is definitely a good solution, but it's not an easy one because in general, it is not a trivial to, it's not trivial to create a unity build with preserving the semantics of the code. So it takes considerable amount of effort to achieve this point when somebody has a unity build. Okay. So another tool is the Clang tidy that I would like to talk about. One of the good points of Clang tidy, it supports rewriting the code. So in case there is a trivial fix to an error, it can actually do the fix. And it has very large amount of checks, and it is growing very rapidly. So it is really hard to keep up what kind of checks are there. And also there are a good amount of security-related checks, and for example, there are also C++ core guideline checks, and most of those checks are based on syntax tree matching, so it's a bit more, it does a bit more shallow analysis than the Clang static analyzer, and it also lacks cross-translation unit support. But fortunately, this is one of the most requested features for both the Clang tidy and the Clang static analyzer, so this might change in the future. So let's talk about what is the best way to integrate these tools into the workflow. Let's do a survey. How many of you has old large legacy projects that are hard to deal with? And how many of you are working on greenfield projects? So it looks like the majority of people are working on legacy projects or large code bases that are hard to change or hard to manage. So one of the possible way to introduce a new static analysis tool into these large projects is to have a policy that new commits should not introduce new reports. And in order to do this, we need incremental analysis, and we also need to be able to do a differential view. So we need to be able to detect which errors are present in after the new commits that weren't there before the commit. So this needs to somehow identify these bug reports, which is not an easy task. And also, once we introduce this policy, we can pick some of the most critical type of reports from the tool and try to fix them gradually. Well, fixing them sometimes means that we should change the code, but I will talk about that a bit later. So for greenfield projects, it is much more easy. We only need to keep the number of reports minimal. And in both cases, it is crucial to set up and integrate these tools into CI, so we can track the number of reports, and we can also, for example, create commit hooks to ensure the quality of the code. So what are the most frequent use cases? When we are running these tools locally, we usually want to do an incremental analysis. So we would like to only check those files that are required to check because of my modification. Basically, the main reason for this is that these tools usually a bit slower than the compilation because they are doing much deeper reasoning than the compiler does. So to best utilize the developer time, we want to do it incrementally. On nightly builds, we have much more time, so we might want to do a full check every night. And also, when we are doing triaging, it is good to have some kind of tool that helps us mark false positive reports and also comment why this is a false positive or mark them fixed or just provide some tools that helps us manage these reports. And also, it is very common that we are not interested in every report. For example, some of the reports might come from third-party headers that we are not allowed to modify. So we just want to skip and we just want to ignore those errors. And it is so the easier to use a tool is the better. So I'd like to advertise an open source tool here that is that supports both the Clang Static Analyzer and Clang Tidy, and support for other analyzers are on the roadmap. And this tool might end up under the LLVM umbrella, and it is actively developed. It supports Mac and Linux. And in case you are interested, how does it work? There was a talk about it in Euro LLVM 2015, sorry. Okay, so what is Code Checker? Code Checker is basically a web viewer for defects. It helps you to manage the reports that you get from the static analysis tools. It helps you filter what are the most important errors to fix first. It helps you to suppress false positive results, and it provides you with a differential view. So for example, when you would like to know which new reports were introduced by a certain commit, you can do that. And it also supports incremental analysis, and you can plug it into basically any build system on the platforms that it supports. And it also has a command line interface for CI integration. And it also has Eclipse integration for local, so for local work. And it also supports Code Compass, which is a code comprehension tool to increase developer productivity. In case you are interested in Code Compass, come to the Lightning Talks tomorrow. I will give a demo about it there. Okay, so one of the best features of Code Checker is that it is very easy to use it. So basically, in order to check a project with both Clang Tidy and the Clang Static Analyzer, we first of course need to install it, which is also not hard, and the instructions are on the GitHub page, and we need to execute one single command. And first we need to give a name for the run, and then we need to give the command that we are used to, that we can use to build the project. And after the check is done, it will print what is the next command that we should issue. And after we execute the next command, we can see connect to it using our browser, and it presents us the results that were found by this tool. And when we are looking at the result, this is how the interface looks like. So this is how we can view the reports. So there are only a few possible mistakes using the Code Checker tool. For example, how should we choose the analysis name? If we are doing a clean build, for example, a nightly build, we should pick a unique name. And in case we are doing an incremental check, then we should pick a name of an existing RAM. So this way, the results of an existing RAM will be updated. And also, when we start the web viewer, it will accept connections from the local host only. If we would like to run it on a CI server, for example, we might want to enable other connections. So we need to pass an additional flag to the code checker. And also for differential view, we first need to select the baseline and then the new run. Okay, so let's talk about how can we write static analysis friendly code and why is static analysis friendly code usually cleaner and more modern than the static analysis unfriendly one. So first of all, in order to please those tools, we should minimize the macro use. And this is also a good practice in C++ in general. The less macro magic is the better. So this is definitely something that one can benefit from. And also, it is better to avoid non-standard extensions because most of the tools were written with standard C++ in mind. And in case we are using code generation tools or we are developing code generation tools, it would be great if we could ensure that those tools are not are generating warning-free code. Also, the more rich types we use, the better, because if we have a lot of types, then type-based alias analysis and other analysis can really helps the tools to understand our code better. And also, in case we can guarantee some kind of safety property of our code using the type system, do so. For example, it is always better to use RAII than relying on a static analysis tool to find resource errors. So if we can find an error using the type checker, then we should rely on the type checker, because that is the best static analysis tools that we have. So if we cannot find a certain kind of error using the type checker, then we can rely on the static analysis tools. Overusing pointers or references are usually bad for those tools, because then they need to reason about aliasing, which is a hard problem. It is great if we can use annotations. For example, no return, deprecated, or nullability. The most important part of annotations is to annotate custom assert functions. So in case you have custom assert functions, annotate them. And if you are developing a library, it is even more important, because users of those library can benefit from this as well. And it is important to analyze the debug build. So in case we are analyzing the debug build, the assertions are enabled, so they are and those assertions convey a lot of useful information for the analyzer tools that they can rely on. And in case we are using arcane build systems, then it is less likely that those tools work well with our code. So let's look at an example. Why is it very important to annotate the custom assertion in a code base? So in this case, the Clang static analyzer might conclude that we can dereference a null pointer. What makes the static analyzer think that is that there is a branch on the nullness of B. And what the static analyzer sees is that the programmer was thinking about the case that the value of B can be null. And even though the programmer was thinking about this case, the programmer references this pointer, which is obviously wrong. But if we annotate the custom assert function to be no return, then the analyzer knows that each time the value of b is null, then we will not dereference it because the custom assertion function will not return. So this is why it is important, because if we annotate those functions, then we can avoid a lot of false positive results. Okay, so let's talk about how to handle the false positive results, because first let's think about what is the most common case that we get a false positive. One possibility is that the analyzer is analyzing an impossible execution path. It can happen, or the analyzer do not know about an invariant. It could not infer it. So the best way to eliminate a false positive is to actually help the analyzer understand your code. So if you make it easier to understand for these tools, sometimes it became also easier to understand to other people. So I think this is an approach that definitely we should take. How can we do this? One great way is to add additional asserts to your code, or making some implicit constructs explicit. This way you can convey the information that this was done intentionally. And also, it is better to use standard APIs than rolling your own solution, because those standard APIs are sometimes handled specially within those analyzer tools. Also, when you are able to rewrite your code in a way that the analyzer can understand it, and the false positive report disappears, you can increase the coverage of the analysis on your code, because what the analyzer does, it finds the reference of a null pointer, it stops the analysis on that execution path, because after that reference, it cannot model the semantics of the program. Undefined behavior just happened according to the analyzer. So how to model the next operation? And because of this problem, each time when you resolve a false positive by rewriting your code in a more concise way, you actually increase the coverage of the analysis of your code, and it also helps readability. Something that you should not do, for example, you should not turn off the core checkers of the static analyzer just to suppress warnings, because in case you do so, those core checkers checks not only report bugs in the Clang static analyzer, but they also helps to model some aspects of your code. So the proper way for this would be to pre-process the results or use code checker to filter out those unwanted results. If a code is very problematic, using a macro, you can exclude it from your code. And when you use false positive suppression, which should always be used only as a final resort, it is very important to comment. Why is it a false positive? Why is it not possible to change the code that the analyzer understands it? What are the requirements to remove this suppression? Because at some point you would like to remove this suppression. Maybe you file the bug for the analyzer and you can remove it once the analyzer is improved. Or maybe you can remove it once a new annotation is introduced, or something like that. And also if these tools try to not report errors from system headers, but if you are not curious about reports from third party headers, it is not the proper way to suppress them using, so you should not mark third party headers as system headers only to suppress reports, because these tools sometimes handle functions from system headers differently than functions from non-system headers. So in this case also the proper solution is to use post-processing or the filtering function of CodeChecker. So to conclude this talk, it is useful to have static analysis in your workflow, because sometimes you need to rewrite the so not only you can find bugs early and you can fix those, but sometimes in order to fix the false positives, to rewrite the code so that the analyzer can understand it, you can improve the readability of your code. There are several powerful tools available for free, so you should definitely invest some time exploring them, because they can find real bugs. And even though it requires some effort to write static analysis friendly code, but it might worth it, especially if you are writing a library, because even if you are not interested in static analysis, your clients might be. So it is great to support those clients as well. And there are some references for the tools that I mentioned. So thank you for your attention, and I'm open to your questions. Okay, so the question was, is there a way to measure the coverage that we get from an analyzer? And unfortunately, it is dependent on the tools. For the Clang static analyzer, you can print statistics that will tell you the percentage of the basic blocks from the control flow graph that were covered. So there are some data, some statistics, but I do not know of any tool that can, for example, visualize what part. Right. What build systems operate well? So the question was, what build systems operate well with the Clang static analyzer? And basically, there are right now two ways to execute the Clang static analyzer. The first one is overwriting some environment variables that define what the C and the C++ compilers are. And if your build system supports those environment variables, you should be good. And the second option, which is only available on Mac and Linux, is to use a trick that the analysis loads a shared library, and that shared library overwrites the exec function family, the exec system call family, and each time there is an exec call to launch a new process, basically it looks up what is the name of the executable that is being invoked, and in case it was a compiler, then it logs the call to the compiler. And this way, it can work independently of the build system. So if you are able, if in case in your environment this works well, it unfortunately not work, not, so it is not a perfect solution, because with similar system call overwriting tricks, other tools also do similar stuff, and they don't work well together. But in case this works in your environment, you are basically good with any build system.
I think they're trying to fix this for that compilation data.
Yes, so CMake can generate a compilation database, and if you use CMake and you pass define to that CMake, it will generate a JSON database which includes the commands that is required to compile your translation units. And for example, Clang Tidy can work on this compilation database, and I think also the Clang static analyzer can also work on that database.
Does Code Combat work with header-only template library?
So the question was whether the Code Compass tool works with header-only libraries, or yes, it does. Well, it does the parsing when so it also works on something like a compilation database. So when you try to parse a header-only library, it is great to have some kind of unit test or something that you can compile, but in case you have, it works.
You mentioned in your talk we should avoid arcane build systems. What do you consider an arcane build system?
Yes, so basically, so most of the build systems that were developed inside the company for private use and nobody outside have ever seen it before, I consider that arcane. Right. So there is a tool called Bear, indeed, and the author of this Bear tool is contributed this tool to the LLVM already. So in the newest versions of Clang, it is a part of the distribution under the name scambuild_py. Because it is written in Python, so yes, these tools are available and make it easy to run the Clang static analyzer on your code.
So we have at least three tools: CppCheck, static analyzer, and Tidy. Is any one of them better than the others, or do I need to run multiple of them?
Okay, so the question was that we have several open source tools. Is one of them better than the other, or we should run all of them? And the Clang Static Analyzer and Clang Tidy, they have different kind of checks. So the best is to run both of them. The CppCheck, I'm not very familiar with it, but I think in case there are some checks in it that is not included in either Clang Tidy or the Clang Static Analyzer, then it is definitely worth to run that as well.
So Clang Tidy says it will run the Clang Analyzer checks. Is that the entire set? That's kind of the way
it works. Sorry, I did not catch it. Could you?
So the Clang Tidy documentation says it can run the Clang Analyzer checks. Can you just run Clang Tidy?
Okay, so the question was that the Clang Tidy. So Clang Tidy can run the static analyzer checks. So is it enough to just run the Clang Tidy tool? And the answer is that when we run the static analyzer checks using Clang Tidy, we get the textual output. And if we go back a few slides, as you can see, so the reports from the Clang static analyzer sometimes includes the execution paths that where the problem occurred, and when we are running the Clang static analyzer directly, we can generate plist files that contains this path, and tools IDEs, for example, can parse these plist files and they can display the this pass. In case we are getting the textual output, it is not easy to parse that, and we cannot reproduce this pass. So in case you are interested in the pass, then you should run the Clang static analyzer checks from the Clang static analyzer executable and not from Clang tidy. Okay, so the question was whether the static analyzer uses the restrict and other keywords to reason about aliasing. And right now, I think it doesn't, but it is definitely something that should be worth to add. So the question was whether the Clang static analyzer can be extended. And yes, you can write your own checks for the Clang static analyzer as well, but it involves more work than with Clang tidy because the static analyzer does a deeper analysis.
Would have been nice to be able to put like a block in the code to say, please ignore this. And I can put a comment that says, here's why I have to do this. It's mm-hmm. cool what I know. And just don't throw a warning. Is there a reason why like Clang tidy doesn't have support for that? I mean, it seems to ignore any attempts to tell Clang, please ignore the following warnings or anything like that.
Okay, so the question is, how can we, did your question involve Clang tidy or? Okay,
Clang itself, you can say like ignore the following warning and it'll work.
Right.
That same block, Clang tidy just seems to skip over and pretend it's
not. So the question is is there a way to make Clang tidy ignore some warnings? And there are some ways. For example, one possibility would be to add the comment in the same line where the error is reported, and the comment should be something like no lint. Because CPP lint has this, I enumerated this. Yes, so there is a tool called CPP lint. It is a Python tool, and it can find violations of the Google coding guidelines, I believe. And this CPP lint has a suppression mechanism that puts a comment in a line and the comment contains the string no lint or something like that, then the issues are suppressed for that line, and the Clang tidy supports this comment as well, but I'm not sure whether it is documented or not.
I don't think it is.
How hard would it be to separate either of those tools from Clang proper for the platform that Clang backend does not exist?
Mm-hmm. If I get it well, the question was how well are these tools separated from the backend? And
can I build on the platform where Clang backend does not?
So the question was whether it is possible to build this or use this when we do not have a backend for the platform. And basically the easy answer would be that yes, because we do not do any code generation, but unfortunately my experience is that when there is a platform that we do not have a backend for, then there are a lot of intrinsics and defines for that platform that are required to make the code compile at all. So in case we cannot even parse the code with Clang, then we cannot use these tools to analyze it. So In most of the cases, it can be done, but it involves a lot of work to add the proper defines and type defs, and so Clang can digest the code, the Clang front end. Okay, the session is over, so I think I will answer the rest of the questions offline. Thank you for your attention.